A man named Jack was walking along a steep cliff one day when he accidentally got too close to the edge and fell. On his way down, he grabbed a branch which temporarily held his fall. He looked down and he saw that the canyon fell straight down for more than 1,000 feet. He looked up and he realized that he's not going to be able to walk up the steep wall of the cliff anymore. So as he was holding on to that branch, he knew his only option would be to yell for help and hope that someone might let down a rope or something. So he started yelling, "Help! Help! Can someone hear me? Help! Help!" But nobody came to help him. And when he was about to give up, he suddenly heard a voice saying, "Jack, Jack, can you hear me?" "Yes, I can hear you. I'm down here. I can see you, Jack. You can see me, but who are you and where are you?" "I'm the Lord, Jack. I'm everywhere." "The Lord, you mean God?" "Yes, Jack, that's me. God, please help me. If you get me down from here, I'll serve you for the rest of my life and I'll stop sinning." "Easy on the promises, Jack. Let's get you down first and we'll talk after that. So listen, Jack, that's what I want you to do." "Okay, Lord, I'll do anything you say." "Okay, so listen carefully. Let go of the branch." "What?" "I said, let go of the branch. Trust me, let go." There was a long silence. And finally, Jack yelled, "Help! Help! Is anyone else up there?" Sometimes God asks pretty difficult things from us, right? About 4 weeks ago, about a month ago, with God's grace, I was talking about true obedience. And we looked at two questions. The first one was, whom can we / should we obey? And the second one was, why should we obey? For tonight, we want to look at another question, and this is going to be, how does true obedience look like? How does true obedience look like? And that's also the title of my message. Stating the fact that there is a true type of obedience, we assume that there is also an obedience which is not according to God's will. And in Matthew chapter 7, verse 21, we read the following, and those are the words of Jesus Christ. "Not everyone who calls out to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven. Only those who actually do the will of my Father in heaven will enter. On judgment day, many will say to me, 'Lord, Lord, we prophesied in your name, we cast out demons in your name, and performed many miracles in your name.' But I will reply, 'I never knew you. Get away from me, you who break God's laws.'" So what name is it about here? Well, since Jesus Christ is talking and those people respond, it's the name of Jesus Christ. So we prophesied in the name of Jesus Christ, cast out demons in the name of Jesus Christ, and did many miracles in the name of Jesus Christ. But you see, those things, although they might be very astonishing, and they are astonishing, what's really gonna count is to do the will of the Father in heaven. True obedience is important. That's what counts. So the first thing you need in order to be truly obedient to God is knowledge. You need to know the will of the Father in heaven. It's knowledge. So let's pretend you and your family decide to move to Canada. And you're having a little baby, 8 months old, who, unlike Flavius and maybe some others, doesn't walk yet at the age of 8 months. So you have a baby walker where you put your baby once in a while, and you take your baby walker with you to Canada, and as you get there, you're inviting all your neighbors over, you're having a little party, you want to be nice, you want to know your neighbors, you're American, right? So everybody comes over, you're kind of overwhelmed with your work, so you put your baby in a baby walker, and everything went pretty good, and then everybody goes home, and a few days later, you receive a fine of $100,000, Canadian dollars, of course, or 6 months in jail for the fact that you have a baby walker. And yes, this law truly exists. They banned the baby walker in the year 2004, and as you can see, I underlined it, owners of baby walkers may be fined up to $100,000 Canadian dollars or sentenced to up to 6 months in jail. That's fine, you can take the picture away. So, what are you gonna do? I mean, you cannot just go to them and say, guys, you know, I'm citizen of the United States. You cannot just apply such a fine, you know. You cannot just put a fine like that to me. Because as soon as you enter a country, the law, the jurisdiction in that country applies to you as well, right? I mean, if a guy is from Germany, and you know in Germany you're allowed to drive as fast as you want on the freeways there, on the Autobahn, and if he comes to the United States, and let's say he drives up to Modestos, most of the time 70 miles per hour, that's what you're allowed, and he drives 200 miles per hour, and then the police stops him, and he says, sir, you know, do not worry about me. Now, I'm used to drive that fast. All my life, I've driven that fast, you know. I'm from Germany. So don't worry about me. Don't worry. It's fine. It doesn't matter. You're in the United States. 70 miles per hour. Doesn't matter if there is no curve in the next 2 hours. Enjoy the road. Watch the grass grow. Whatever. Just drive whatever the law is here. You cannot just, right? So the second thing is you cannot just go and say, you know, gentlemen, I didn't know about this law. You think if I would have known, you think I would have brought my baby walker with me to Canada? I mean, I left my rifle, which I used to carry right on my back in Texas, but I didn't know that the real problem here are baby walkers. I wouldn't have brought it with me. You cannot say that either because, you see, as soon as you enter a country, you need to inform yourself about the laws in that country. So, why am I telling this whole story? Well, there is a point. Look, we're living on this planet called Earth. Somebody created this planet. This somebody is God. And He established some rules and laws for this planet called Earth. Like the law of gravity, which we know from our school was discovered by Isaac Newton because he saw an apple fall from a tree, right? That's what it says, at least, in Wikipedia. And, I mean, I don't know if he's the first guy who saw an apple fall from a tree, but he discovered gravity. But he didn't create gravity. He cannot change anything to that law. This law was created by God. And God established that law to exist. He made it there. He made us human beings, and He has a plan and a purpose for every single one of us. So if we do not care about His plan and purpose, if we do not care about the law of gravity, if we do not care about what He truly wants from us, how He truly wants us to obey Him, that doesn't change anything to the fact that this law exists, that the rules exist, that there's gonna be a judgment day. So maybe now I have drawn a picture of a pretty strict and severe God. But actually, our God is very different. Our God makes a lot of steps towards us so that we might understand His true nature. And the first thing He gives us is moral law. Is our conscience. And C.S. Lewis said in Mere Christianity, conscience reveals to us a moral law whose source cannot be found in the natural world, thus pointing to a supernatural lawgiver. This is basically a great apologetical argument to prove that our God truly exists. But it's not just an apologetical argument, as C.S. Lewis puts it here. It's a standard. It's something what we receive from God, we have it within us, and we understand what God wants from us. We understand how God wants to live our lives through our conscience. The second thing God gives us is creation. We can see creation, we can feel creation, we can hear creation and things God created. And in Romans chapter 1 verse 19, we read that Paul said the following: they know the truth about God because he has made it obvious to them. For ever since the world was created, people have seen the earth and sky. The earth and sky basically summarizing God's creation. And you see it now again. Through everything, you see that word? Through everything God made, they can clearly see three things: his invisible qualities, his eternal power, and divine nature. See, even Paul had this three things thing. So I know I heard once, maybe we have it from the communists. Maybe not, maybe we have it from Paul. Who knows? Anyway, so they have no excuse for not knowing God. They have no excuse for not knowing God, because we can see him through creation. The third thing God gave us, and this is very, very special. Our pastor just talked about it in a great way. Is the scripture, the Bible, the Bible. Have you ever seen that video of those people from China who received those Bibles for the first time? How happy they were, how they were crying. This Bible was written over a span of 1,500 years. 66 books written by all kind of people in three languages: Aramaic, Hebrew, and Greek. Those people were, some were very educated, like Dr. Luke or King Solomon. But there were people like the shepherd Amos. But all those people write over this large span of 1,500 years, and the Bible doesn't contradict itself. Why? Because although it was written by humans, it was inspired by God. And it's inerrant. It has no errors. It is perfect. It is truthful. It is trustworthy. It has authority. It has clarity. It has sufficiency. It has necessity. This scripture is perfect. It's translated in 670 languages. Parts of it are translated in 3,312 languages. This book has a fantastic accuracy. You know, if you compare the New Testament to all those work of Aristotle and Platon and Homer and all those Greek philosophers, their accuracy is by far not like the accuracy of the New Testament. Even people from secular history are astonished and amazed every time they see confirmed through God what accuracy the Bible has. Like when they discovered the scrolls from the Dead Sea. An amazing accuracy. Why? Well, because it was inspired by God. Because it's God's word for us. Hallelujah. And in this Bible, in John chapter 14, verse 6, we read the following. Jesus told him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me." You know what's interesting? This passage was written after Paul said to the Romans, there is no excuse for not knowing God. I learned that at Ecclesia Bible College. So maybe more people come now. No, actually, it's really good. It's great. God keeps making steps towards us. Do you see that? I mean, he says to Paul, there is no excuse. Then he comes with through John and says, I am the way, the truth and the life. Not the truth like our society says nowadays. You know, I have my truth, you have your truth. No. The truth, Jesus Christ. Amen. The fourth thing God gives us are testimonies. So many people writing through history about God, testifying his awesomeness, his greatness. The fifth thing, the work of the Holy Spirit. The work of the Holy Spirit. I mean, every time I'm evangelizing a person and I'm talking with a person about God, you know, it's so amazing. You know, I kind of go with the plan and I hope that in a certain span of days or weeks, I'm getting with that person somewhere. And as I'm getting closer, and by the way, what I need to mention is at the start, I have kind of a feeling, God use me, because maybe there was no other person on earth who talked to this person about you. So I want to do this job. You know, sometimes we go with this mentality. And then we talk to a person and we have no idea what's happening, what happened is in his life. And then as you get closer to him, he tells you, you know, you're just telling me that, but you know, it's so interesting because my grandpa, he used to tell me such a similar thing. You know, when I was going through that struggle, you know, it's so interesting that you tell me that right now. Yeah, and just listening to those people, you realize something. And I'm trembling and humbled every single time. You know why? Because I see the work of the Holy Spirit. I see how he was working in this life for such a long time already. And I'm just a little piece in that great work what God wants to do in this person's life. Because it's not our project. It's not our project. It's God's project to transform lives. It's God's project to change a life forever and to save him. He cares so much about it. He cares so much about it. And he confirmed it to me so many times how much he cares about those unsaved people. Therefore, we should never, ever, for no price, stand in the way of God when he wants to save. We should never stand in the way of God when he wants to save somebody. Now, the second thing what God wants, and the second thing what we truly need if you want to be truly obedient to God. And it's actually just a result of all that mentioned above, of all that knowledge. When you have the moral law, when you have creation, the Bible, testimonies, the work of the Holy Spirit, that's not just to satisfy, you know, your knowledge and just to satisfy you as a person, that you know more, you wake up smarter. No. Something should happen in your heart. You should discover God and you should discover his love. You should discover God's love. Love is such a powerful word. It's such a powerful word. Although in nowadays society, it got so weak. I mean, nowadays, you can love a lot of things. I just looked for three pictures. So you could love an F12 Berlinetta Ferrari, or you can love a Pomeranian puppy, or Biff Wellington, and so many other things you can love nowadays, right? Cute, puppy, nice Ferrari, and we love all kinds of things. But if we look at God's love, and if we look at 1 Corinthians chapter 13, we see that he talks in such a different way about this word. Love is patient and kind, it says in verse 4. Love is not jealous or boastful or proud or rude. It does not demand its own way. It is not irritable, and it keeps no record of being wronged. It does not rejoice about injustice, but rejoices whenever the truth wins out. Love never gives up, never loses faith, is always hopeful, and endures through every circumstance. Prophecy and speaking in unknown languages and special knowledge will become useless. Useless. Prophecy? Seriously? Prophecy? When a prophet is coming to our church, the church is full. Everybody wants to hear, to see maybe God has something special, something new for us. And don't understand me wrong. It's not bad to come to church when a prophet is coming to the church. But it is bad to not come to church when you know that Jesus Christ is here every single time. That is bad, you know, because we always want to receive God's word to that perfect vessel. No, God, I want you to talk to me through that person because somehow I feel that he's special. I feel that he's special. And that then God comes and talks to you through a shepherd like Amos, you know, because God decides through whom he wants to speak to you. Special knowledge. When I see that word, I'm thinking right away about my last trip to Romania. I visited my grandmom. She's a great person. And she said, you know, Lucian, you really need to watch that person on YouTube. It was already pretty impressive, my grandma mentioning YouTube. And I started listening to that person, what she said, and you know, so much special knowledge. Man, that person knew everything. What clothes we're gonna wear in heaven. What color, what size. All those details, like that special insight, you know. And people nowadays, they're looking for that special insight. And I'm not talking about scriptures here. I'm talking about special insight outside of scriptures. Paul had to fight with people like that too, by the way, you know. Special insight. All that special knowledge is gonna be useless. You know why? Because there is something way more special than that. And that is love. But love will last forever. I remember I was talking to my dad one day and I said, you know, Dad, I can't wait to get to heaven and talk with Peter and Paul and ask them about those verses. And he said, yeah, maybe, but you know what? You know what? When you're gonna get in heaven and you're gonna see Jesus Christ, son, I don't think you're gonna care that much about all those other things that much anymore. Because if you have Jesus Christ in front of you, you're gonna be full with love, with happiness, with joy. Jesus Christ. To see Jesus Christ face to face. I mean, is there anything better than that? Love will last forever. You know, it's so interesting because Pharisees, I learned one day in the theology class that what Pharisee means. Somehow I never looked it up. So I learned that Pharisee means to be set apart. It comes from that Hebrew word, and it means set apart. And you know, there is another word which means set apart, and that is holy. Isn't it interesting? All those Pharisees in the time of Jesus Christ, people who were meant to be set apart. And Jesus has so many problems with them. Why? Because they were not truly set apart. They were not set apart for the right reasons. So if you just set apart, if you just live a life full with rules and laws, you know, without any significance, if you just come to church and you don't want to change anything in your life, if you do not want to be transformed, you just want to come and feel somehow better about yourself, If you don't want God's true love to be in your heart, then it's just a pain. It's just a struggle. Your whole life is just a struggle. Just a set of rules without meaning. Without meaning. Because what really counts is God's love. And we have so much knowledge, what we can't find like in an instant nowadays. But what we truly need is God's love in our heart. We need to live God's love. We need to live through the fruit of the Holy Spirit. Amen? That's what the world needs. That's what the world truly needs. To see that you're different. To see that you're different. The third thing you need in order to be truly obedient, and the third thing we need, is faith. Faith. In Luke chapter 5, it's such a great passage, such a great passage. Like all the passages from Scripture, but I really like this one about faith. In verse 3 it says, then he got, it's about Jesus Christ, so then he got into one of the boats, which was Simon's. So when we read Simon's, we know it refers to Peter. Very good. Peter at this time was not Jesus Christ's disciple yet. That happens in verse 11. So now, Jesus asked him to put out a little from the land. And he sat down and taught the multitudes from the boat. Okay, so teaching, Jesus Christ is teaching the multitudes of people, a lot of people from the boat. When he had stopped speaking, he said to Simon, launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch. But Simon answered and said to him, Master, we have toiled all night and caught nothing. Nevertheless, and now underline, at your word, I will let down the net. At your word. You might be going through some struggles in your life. You might have a lot of tribulations in your life. Your life might be really tough in this moment. And maybe you do not see the light at the end of the tunnel. Maybe you're hanging on to that branch, and then God comes to you and says, let go. Let go. Let go the net. Just throw the net in the water, Simon. But God, it makes no sense, God. You know, I'm a fisherman. That's what I do for a living. That's my business, God, you know. I mean, we tried at night when it was silence. We tried at night when we have great chances to catch fish. And we didn't try just for a minute or two or five. We tried all night. And now after you making so much noise, after all those people are around here, you just say, you know, throw the net in the water? It makes no sense to my mind. It makes no sense how I can grab and hold down, let that branch go, because my mind tells me I'm gonna fall 1,000 feet. My mind tells me I'm not gonna be able to catch any fish. My mind tells me, God, that it doesn't make sense what you're asking from me. But at your word, at your word, that spark of faith, that mustard seed, at your word, God, if you truly want that from me, God, if you really truly want me to do that, God, although it doesn't make any sense, although I don't see where it's gonna go, at your word, what happens? Verse 6. And when they had done this, they caught a great number of fish, and their net was breaking. And their net was breaking, because when God blesses you, the net is breaking. Because God's blessings are so powerful, you cannot even imagine. God's power and God's power through His Word is just amazing. We sing that song, there is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. Do you truly believe it? Do you truly believe that, church? Well, we need to live it. Because there's gonna be a moment in your life when God is gonna come and say, well, now you're hanging on that branch. I didn't get you there. I mean, I never told you to walk that close to the edge. Or maybe circumstances happen and somehow you need to go through that struggle, whatever it is. It's not always your fault. And that God comes, and He comes at the right time. He comes at the right time, and it's the time of your test of faith and obedience. And God came to Abraham, and Abraham was great. He was great. He went very far with his obedience. But I want to tell you about somebody else who was even better than Abraham. Because you see, there is only one who was perfect in his obedience. And that one was Jesus Christ. In Philippians chapter 2, verse 5, we read, you must have the same attitude that Christ Jesus had. Though he was God, he did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges. He took the humble position of a slave and was born as a human being. When he appeared in human form, he humbled himself in obedience to God and died a criminal's death on a cross. And even the death of the cross, he gave his life. He gave his life for us. He was in heaven. All the angels were glorifying him. And he decided to come to earth to take this human body. What, if you compare it to the glory he had, was a body of a slave. And people mocked him, they beat him, they spit on him. They talked in a very cruel way to him. They put a cross on his back. He was beaten. He was put up on that cross, nails in his hands and in his feet. And all those things, why? He didn't deserve it. See, Jesus Christ didn't deserve it. None of it. Just think about it. We're so used to this. We're so used to this passage. And God talked to me last time as I was preparing for this message again. And he told me, how much are you willing to sacrifice for me? How much are you willing to suffer when you do not deserve it? Because we read it and we say, well, that's great. Jesus Christ was great. But don't forget verse 5. You must have the same attitude that Christ Jesus had. How far, and that's basically the question I want to leave you with tonight. How far are you willing to go with your obedience? How far? Abraham went very far. He gave up the most precious thing he had. Jesus Christ went the furthest because he gave his life. And he is God, and he gave his life for us so that we might live. The question what remains is, how far are you willing to go? How much are you willing to give up for God? How much are you willing to suffer? That's the question what I want to leave you with tonight. Amen.